know it was bad. But anyways, as we were, you know, praying about what, you know, the seminar should be about, the Lord gave me Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. For the grace of God hath appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to the intent that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So that's what I want this to be all about, is how can we be godly women in an ungodly world? So our first guest speaker is Brandi Harrison. She's a dear friend, lives down in Chino, and she's coming up to share with us what the Lord gave her.
Let's go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father God, we're all here because we love you and we want to know you and serve you and be pleasing to you. And I pray, Lord, that you would bless your word. Father, that you would minister to our hearts. Lord, that your Holy Spirit would just anoint the message, Father, that it would accomplish that which you intend, Father. And I know that there's so many wonderful women in this room, and we're all at different places in our walk with you, Father. So I pray, Lord, that your Spirit would tailor your word to minister specifically to each individual, Father, because we all need you. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning. Okay, so the theme of our conference is being a godly woman in an ungodly world. And the theme verse out of Titus is about the Lord purifying us from all unrighteousness and preparing us as we wait for his return. And as he's preparing us, he's turning us into his special people who are zealous for good works. So I want to focus on what it means to be a true disciple of Jesus in these last days, because we are living in a day where being a disciple of Jesus is, it's truly scary. I mean, it could literally cost us everything. So, as Paul was writing to Titus, Titus was pastoring a church on the island of Crete, and he told Titus that he had two main jobs to do. The first job, he needed to disciple and raise up godly men who had solid character and solid walks with the Lord so that they could serve in ministry. The second thing that he was supposed to do is he needed to rebuke certain individuals who were false disciples of Jesus Christ. And he says in verse 10 that they were insubordinate, idle talkers, and deceivers. In fact, in verse 16, he says something really harsh. He says, they profess to know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable, disobedient, and disqualified for every good work. And when you think about our churches today, the pastors still have the same job. And we have people sitting in our churches, I mean, maybe, hopefully not, I don't think this church, but all over, I mean, we know what's going on in the churches, how the churches are falling into apostasy. And we have people in churches all over this country that are the same way. In fact, I'm not sure if you recognize all these people, but we have a lot of Christians in our country who are more inspired by women like Jen Hatmaker, who says that homosexual marriage can be holy before God, and Oprah Winfrey, who teaches New Age spirituality, and Joel Osteen, who thinks that God is a genie in a bottle. And then when you think about what happened, when you think about what happened this year, so many millions of people attending this women's march, and I have Christian friends on Facebook who said they went. And maybe they didn't expect, maybe they didn't know what it was going to be like, but do they really support the message of this movement? Do they really support, I mean, this movement, they celebrated abortion, they promoted Islam, and they demonstrated immorality. You couldn't take your children without exposing them to filth. And Madonna and Ashley Judd, their speeches, they're preachers. I don't know if people realize it, but they're preaching a false gospel, right? And you know what? This isn't new, because women in Jesus' day, They also had powerful female celebrity icons. I think of Herodias and Salome, who used seduction to gain power and influence. They wanted the head of godly people on a platter. If you speak against their lifestyle, they're going to want your head on a platter. And it's the same today. And they're following in the footsteps of Jezebel. So the false gospel that the world is preaching to the women today, it comes out of the Garden of Eden. It is the serpent on the tree saying, "Did God really say? Did God really say you can be like God?" You know, and he says, and it says, eat the fruit. Do what you want. You can decide for yourself what is right or wrong. And that is simply not true. It's a false gospel of selfishness, indulgence, and worldliness. And we as godly women, we are not called to follow these cultural icons. We need to follow Christ. We need to take up our cross and live for him. We need to be like Anna, the widowed prophet, who spent her life in the temple praying and fasting, and the Lord rewarded her by showing her Jesus when he was just a child. We need to be like Timothy's mother and grandmother, who faithfully taught the word of God to the next generation. We need to be like the female disciples who left everything to follow Jesus because he had delivered them from demons and sin and pride. We need to be like Mary and Martha, who loved Jesus so much and welcomed him into their home. And the woman in Luke who brought the alabaster box of costly ointment, she gave everything because she knew he was worth it. What does it mean to be a disciple? Well, technically, a disciple just means a student or apprentice. But Jesus, when he describes what it means to be his disciple, he sets an incredibly high standard. In fact, in three places in the New Testament, Jesus says, if you want to be his disciple, you need to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow him. And for some Christians, people who call themselves Christians, this is too much to ask them. They don't want to do it. The rich young ruler walked away, and many other people pretend. But the thing is if we are willing to become his disciple, we are going to become more like him. Luke 6:40 says, a disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is perfectly trained will be like his teacher. And isn't that what we want? We want to be like Jesus. And he gives us an invitation to discipleship that is very hard to refuse. He says in Matthew 11:28-30, he says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for you will find rest. I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And this is actually a beautiful practical symbol. When training a new animal, such as an ox, to plow, ancient farmers often yoked it to a stronger, more experienced animal that would carry the burden and guide it through the learning process. And that's what the Lord does for us. He teams up with us and he walks next to us. Now, how many of you guys are weary and heavy laden? I mean, we have busy lives. Women have really, really hard lives. But are you trying to do it on your own? Because that's the problem. To be yoked to Christ, I was thinking about it. If I was yoked to Christ, what would that mean? I pictured a yoke and Jesus next to me. And if you are yoked to Christ, he is next to you all day long, side by side. That's awesome. If you are yoked to Christ, your ear is in the perfect position to hear from him, to hear his word. If you are yoked to Christ, he is leading you and he's directing your steps. You don't have to worry about your future because he knows where he's taking you. If you're yoked to Christ, his strength is overcoming all of your weaknesses. He is bearing your burdens. If you're yoked to Christ, his peace is dissolving all of your anxieties, and he gives you rest for your soul, not just your body. He says, I give you rest for your soul. There's nowhere else on the planet that we can find rest for our souls. We are so lucky. And this image of practical lifestyle living with Jesus, it reminds me of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 5-9, the Shema. It says, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all your soul, and all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. So this is practically walking with God. You love him with everything that you have, and you think about him during the day. When you're sitting in your house, you're talking about him. When you're walking through the grocery store, you're talking about him. When you're driving in your car, you're talking about him. You're teaching his word diligently to your children, but you're also casually talking about the Lord throughout the day. The Jews, they had these little boxes that they would have the scriptures in, and they would carry them around like on their forehead, and that's what it's referring to, and they put it in their doorways. We don't do that in our culture, but the idea of having the Word of God being before us to remind us, we could still do that. We could take post-it notes and write scriptures on them and put them up on the mirror or put them in our car somewhere we could see them. I know people who know how to do calligraphy and they make these beautiful pictures for their home. My friend, she has a chalkboard and every week she writes new scriptures on it to remind herself. Simple things. I used to, when I was working, I used to write the references on my hand right here. It probably looked really dirty. But every time I would look down at my hand, I would remember what the Lord spoke to me in the morning. And it was worth it. So if we're talking about reading his word and reminding ourselves of his word, let's talk about reading plans, because we have to plan to be in his word. So I don't know. I think it's wonderful if we all have different reading plans. So these are just suggestions. I don't want to throw any legalism on you or say it has to be done a certain way. It's the word of God. Read it, you know. If you don't read often or you've never read the Bible, maybe start with the book of Matthew and get to know Jesus. And I don't think it has to be a lot each day, even if you're reading a segment and focusing on it and saying, what can I learn about Jesus? What can I learn about my God? What do I need to change? How is he encouraging me? Interact with the Word of God. Pray about it. It doesn't have to be a lot. I do like the one-year Bible. I've gone through it for 20 years, and I'm not perfect. I miss days here and there. If you're interested in the one-year Bible, they have an audio version that you could listen to. It's 15 to 20 minutes a day. So you could listen to the Bible while you're cooking dinner or while you're folding laundry. And also the Walk with the Word ministry. I think it takes longer to get you through the Bible, and that's great because you can slow down and take your time. And they have reading plans, amazing study helps, and he encourages journaling. And speaking of journaling, if you don't have a prayer journal, I love having one because my mind wanders. So I write down my prayers, and I write down what verses I liked from my reading. And then you can always go back and reread it. So I just want to encourage you. I think about Bible reading. Sometimes we overwhelm ourselves and we do too much. And then we think, well, I can't maintain this. So then you stop doing it. It's not a buffet. You don't go to a buffet and eat as many calories as you need for the entire week, right? You go because you're going to be hungry. You're going to be hungry tomorrow. So just eat. Eat the word of, like, eat as much as you need each day. It's more about the consistency of seeking the Lord, making him a part of your day, making him a part of your life, being yoked to him. And Matthew 4:4 says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. We need his word more than food. So what is the secret to living a busy and stressful and hectic life? Well, Jesus showed us, because he was busier and he had a more stressful life than we do. From day one, he had enemies trying to trip him up, accuse him of wrongdoing, and even kill him. He had endless needs to minister to, delivering people from illness, from leprosy, from demons, from sin, constantly ministering. People always wanted to hear from him. People were so desperate to hear from him that they even ripped the roof off of a building to lower their friend to him. He couldn't really get away as much as he needed to. He was constantly traveling, constantly ministering, constantly reaching out. And yet, the Bible doesn't say he went to bed early or slept in late because he was tired. It says the opposite. After a busy day, he would go up a mountain and he would pray. He would pray to his father. Before a busy day, it says he would get up before it was dark, or while it was still dark, before the sun came up, and he would go to a secluded place and spend time with his father. And if Jesus needed to spend time with the Lord, what makes us think that we can't? Like, what makes us think that we don't need to? We need it more. We need it so much more. Here's those verses for him praying. Evenings, mornings, by himself, and often. And he's our example, remember? He doesn't say to us, come to me if you, oops. He doesn't say to us, come to me if you have extra time, or come to me if you feel like reading your Bible, or come to me if you're a pastor and it's your job so you have to. He calls out to normal people, come to me if you are busy, if you are weary and heavy laden. And so if we're yoked to Christ, how can we walk in sin, right? I mean, we're connected to him. We can't grab the yoke and pull him off the road of righteousness onto the path of iniquity. We would literally have to take the yoke off and make a decision to walk away from him. And you know what? It happens. People do that. 2 Corinthians 6:14, it's talking about being unequally yoked together with unbelievers. It says, what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And this scripture is often applied to dating relationships, and rightfully so. But that is not the only application. It also applies to any type of relationship where the world or an unbeliever is influencing us to pull away from Christ or to disobey his word. We cannot let worldly thinking pull us away from the yoke we have in Christ. And yet we see this happened because there was a man named Demas, and he was actually a missionary, and he traveled with Paul, and he shared the gospel. And yet Paul says in 2 Timothy 4:10, for Demas, having loved this world, has deserted me. He left ministry to go back to the world. And, so he took off that yoke. 1 John 2:15 through 17 says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. So we have to choose. We will be yoked, but we will either be yoked to Christ or we will be yoked to the world. And we can't have both. So if we are worldly, we're not walking in that yoke of Jesus Christ. And actually, I see this. And here's this graphic I picked because you would be surprised how many people that identify as Christian have lives that are marked by these images. And I even have Facebook friends who go to church on Sundays, and this is what they talk about. This is what they are into. And I think, why isn't the Holy Spirit convicting them? We're to be in the world, but not of the world, like a ship that's supposed to be in the water. Water's not supposed to be in the ship. If there's water in the ship's going down. The ship has a problem. It's the same way with the world. If the world is influencing us, then we are unequally yoked to the world. And it can come through a book, a movie, a TV show, a magazine, or even through a worldly Christian friend. Be careful, even if they call themselves Christians, that if they're influencing you to things that are not biblical, be careful. And I want to pause real quick, too, because we always focus on entertainment. But I want to mention advertising, because as women, we also need to be careful of advertising. The very nature of advertising and marketing is to create discontent, right? It makes you feel like you're incomplete, or unhappy, or not good enough. Like, you need this thing, right? So they're appealing to the sin of covetousness and greed. We need to be really careful. People go into massive debt so that they can purchase things that they think are going to solve all their problems, and they will not be satisfied. The only way to be satisfied is through Jesus. The world tells you you need to look this way, dress this way, decorate your house this way, think this way, relax this way, eat this way, exercise this way, so much pressure. Jesus says, you need to come away. You need to come away with me. Song of Solomon 2:10, come away with me, my beloved. Matthew 6:31, come away and find rest. Romans 12:2 says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So now that we've talked about what it means to be a disciple and to be surrendered to the Lord and be willing to not be yoked to the world, let's talk about Titus 2:11-14. Rebecca read it earlier. It says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. The word grace here in Greek is charis, and it doesn't just include forgiveness or unmerited favor. Actually, Strong's Concordance says, it's amazing. It says, grace is the merciful kindness by which God, exerting his holy influence upon souls, turns them to Christ, keeps them, strengthens them, increases them in Christian faith, knowledge, affection, and then kindles them to the exercise of Christian virtues. Basically, the work of grace in our life does so much for us. We can't take credit for anything. And this grace has come as an opportunity for everyone to become right with God, and it teaches us to be holy. The word teaches here is, it means to train as you would train a child. It's actually the same Greek word that they use when they're using the word discipline or chastening. It's the word used in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 6, where it says, whom the Lord loves, he chastens. And God proves that we're his children as he disciplines us when we get off track. Like he brings us back to him. That's part of his grace. And if we love him, we will surrender to that work. And what do we have to repent from? I mean, a lot of us, when we got saved, we repented from things that we probably don't even want to mention. And but the thing is we're not done repenting. We are going through this process of sanctification, where when we were saved, we were justified, and we received Christ's righteousness. But now, through his Holy Spirit, he's working this sanctification, and he's actually purifying us right now. And it's going to continue for the rest of our lives. So things that we might not think are a big deal, little attitudes, impatience, maybe we lose our temper, we're snippy, we say things we shouldn't, the Lord is working that out. He's not done. He's gonna keep going. And so there's lists of sins in the New Testament of the works of the flesh and sin. The one I want to look at is 2 Timothy 3, because it describes what people in the church are going to look like in the last days. And we don't want to be on this list. 2 Timothy 3, 1-5, it says, but know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money. We find this in churches. Boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying its power, and from such people turn away. Notice the last characteristic is having a form of godliness, although they've denied its power. They look like Christians on the outside, but they haven't believed that the Holy Spirit can really fix them on the inside. It reminds me of Matthew 23, where Jesus is talking to the scribes and Pharisees, and he calls them hypocrites. He says that they're like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but on the inside, they're full of dead man's bones and all uncleanness. In verse 28, he says, even so, you also, outwardly appear righteous to men, but inside you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. And this is exactly what was going on in the church in Crete. And repenting of sin can be hard, you know? But pretending like we have is not enough because God sees, you know? And so I think it's good that it's hard, because if we realize we can't do it on our own, then we can't take credit for it, you know? It's not about willpower, it's about the Lord's power. In fact, Romans 8:13 says, if you live under the power of sin, you will die. But by the Spirit's power, you can put to death the sins you commit, then you will live. By the Spirit's power, not willpower. And Romans 8:5-6 says, for those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh. Those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So how do we know if we're living for the flesh or for the Spirit? It's whatever's going through our mind, whatever we're setting our mind on. If most of our day we're thinking about carnal things and we're not thinking about the Lord, our minds are set on the flesh. If throughout our day we're remembering the Lord and thinking about his word and taking opportunities, maybe you're listening to a Bible study or putting on worship music, that's how you become more spiritually minded. Galatians 5:16-17 talks about a battle that we go through between the flesh and the Spirit. So I say, walk by the Spirit and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other. And I think about this because so many times people try to just fight their sinful nature. But the sinful nature is a bully. And, you know, it's really hard to tell him no. And so what you have to do is you have to starve him, right? You have to starve the bully, and you have to feed the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. So strengthen yourself in spiritual things, you know, in the Holy Spirit, and then the bully will shrink, and you'll be able to say no to him, and he'll die. In fact, the stronger I am in the Lord, the easier it is for me to be holy. And it's the only lasting way. It's the only lasting way to diminish your sinful nature. Galatians 6:8 says, for he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And Pastor Chuck Smith said, so many movies, TV programs, all designed to sow to the flesh, to get the flesh excited. Don't be deceived. If you watch these movies, if you look at these magazines, if you feed your flesh, then you're going to reap of the flesh corruption. Don't be deceived. You cannot feed the flesh and reap of the Spirit. Now, I'm not trying to be legalistic and say, I mean, if you want to throw your TV away, that's great. I'm not saying that, but I think we need to pray and ask the Holy Spirit, ask the Lord, Lord, is this program, is this pleasing to you? Is this promoting sinfulness? Am I compromising here? Because if we're compromising, what goes in comes out, you know? And so therefore, what do we want to go in? More of the Word of God, more of worship, more prayer, more fellowship. We need to walk in the Spirit, you know, and it's not legalism, because if you are yoked to Christ, if you are denying yourself and becoming a disciple, the Holy Spirit is lovingly telling you yes and no to everything. And, you know, you don't even really need other people to give you a list, because you have the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, and you're willing to surrender. And really, it's simple, you know? But he won't deliver us against our will. If we are bound to continue in our way, he will let us, you know? So we need him to change our hearts, you know? And we need to be willing to let go of everything to follow him. Let's go back to the scripture. So we talked about the first part, how the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. The next part is looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our blessed hope. What is our blessed hope? It's not the rapture. It's not heaven. It's Jesus. It's Jesus himself. We need to be longing for him. We need to be looking for him. We need to be waiting for him. In Mark chapter 2, Jesus identifies himself as the bridegroom. And the New Testament identifies us, the church, as the bride. And just as there was a betrothal period in biblical times where the bridegroom would go away and prepare a place, the bride would have to wait for him to come back, and she would have to be faithful and ready. And we see a parable in Matthew 25 of the wise and the foolish virgins. It talks about how, it says, the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight a cry was heard, "Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him." Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish one said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "No, lest there should not be enough for us and you. But go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves." And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered and said, "Assuredly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you neither know the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming." Jesus had just been teaching about what to expect in the last days, and it's not fun. I mean, aside from all of the tribulation type stuff, the thing that is really, really interesting is there's going to be so much spiritual deception, and I think we're seeing a lot of that right now starting, and also there's going to be increased persecution. So as this bride waits for her bridegroom, the threat of being persecuted is greater. It's interesting that the wise virgins were still able to sleep. They must have had incredible faith and trust in the Lord. So the 10 virgins are people who profess religious beliefs. Their job is to wait for the coming of the Lord and to bear a light. Philippians 2:15 says that you may be blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. And Matthew 5:14 says that you are the light of the world. Well, so we're the light. The lamp symbolizes the word of God. Psalm 119:105 says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." In scripture, the oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. Now, 5 did not have the oil, so they did not have the Holy Spirit, so they couldn't illuminate the word of God. Okay, so they had a lamp, a Bible, that could not be illuminated by the Holy Spirit. Romans 8, verse 9 says, "Now if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his." Notice they were wise and foolish virgins, not good and bad virgins. Today we think of fools as people who lack sense, but in biblical days, it was people who disregard the word of God, whose waywardness is continually toward foolishness. And fools, they don't learn from their mistakes. They keep making the same mistake over and over and over. Solomon gives a description in Proverbs of what a fool is like. He says, "They hate knowledge. They take no pleasure in understanding. They proclaim folly and hate discipline and correction. They lose their temper quickly, have boastful and proud speech, commit adultery, and the foolish woman tears down her own house with her own hands." It reminds me of what we just read in 2 Timothy. Their lives are not characterized by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit does so many things for us. Oh, missed it. Okay, this is not an exhaustive list of what he does, but I just want to go through it real quick, because he guides us into all truth. He testifies of Jesus Christ. He comforts us, strengthens us, helps us obey, gives us joy in our afflictions, transforms us, produces fruit in our lives, teaches us spiritual things, directs us, fills us, frees us, gives us spiritual gifts, sanctifies us, empowers us, seals us, and gives us access to the Father. I want all that. I want that. And that's for us as believers. And so one of the most important keys of Christian readiness and waiting for Jesus is being filled with the Holy Spirit and having his word. Ephesians 5, 18 and 19 says, "Do not be drunk with wine, which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, making melody in your hearts to the Lord." The grammar here for be filled with the Spirit, the be is not past tense. It is not a one-time thing. It's a continual thing. It means be being filled, be constantly filled with the Holy Spirit. And when we're saved, the Holy Spirit comes in and dwells us. And when we're baptized in the Spirit, he comes upon us and he empowers us so that we could preach the gospel boldly and we can serve him with gifts. But we also need a constant filling of the Holy Spirit, or else we become lukewarm, dull, apathetic, and distracted. So 5 out of 10 were outward Christians. They spent time with Christians. They hung out with Christians. They were probably at church. But they weren't Christians. And I want to say, going to church is great. Oh my goodness, I love church. But there's people that go to churches that are not real Christians. And I truly believe, just to look at our lives and examine our lives and say, am I Christian at church or am I Christian everywhere? You know, because I think it really is important that when we're at home and we're alone and nobody's looking, are we still Christian? Do we read? Do we pray? Do we worship? Do we obey when no one's looking? You know, we need to be consistent. That way we're not left with a Bible in our hands, but not in our hearts. A lamp that won't shine, right? And ultimately, if that's what we are, the Lord will say, I never knew you. And yet we don't need to be afraid of this, because today it's not too late. The Bible says in Luke 11:13 that the Father is better than our earthly. It says, if you then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So if we don't have the Holy Spirit in our lives, it is simply because we didn't want it enough to ask. So you can have this. And also, I think we need to wait with a proper perspective. We need to have our priorities right, not living for earthly things. 2 Peter 3:11 says, therefore, since all these things are going to be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? I love this verse because all of my false priorities, they just fall down in light of this verse. Everything that we spend so much time worrying about and working for is all going to burn. The only thing that really matters is people. The only thing that we can take with us is people. Our priority is discipling. Our priority is discipling our family, our friends, our loved ones, people in the community, people Jesus puts in your life. The next part of Titus 2 is verse 14, where it says, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. The Lord wants us to be his own special people. And as we're yoked to him and we're walking a life of a disciple, and he's transforming us and making us more like him, this is what's happening. And we're becoming useful. We're able to be used. 1 Peter 2:9 says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, again, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So we are saved by grace through faith, not works. We don't do good works to earn our salvation. We do good works because we're saved. And it says we are God's workmanship. Now, we made things today. We made our centerpieces, so that's our workmanship, right? But we're God's workmanship. And the word in Greek is poema, and it's the word we get the English word poem from. And as God works in our lives, we become like a poem. We become like his work of art. We have his fingerprints on us. I think of my favorite painters. I like to go to the museum, and I like to look at certain paintings, certain artists. And I'll stand in front of the picture, And I'll think about this. I don't know that other people would, but I do. I'll think, wow, the artist stood right here, and he worked on this right here. And I feel like I'm close to him because, you know, I'm standing where he would have stood. And I look at his brush strokes and the globs of paint and the colors he chose and the shapes, and I just think, wow, this is one of a kind. This is so unique. I love it. And yet, we could look at each other the same way. I could stand in front of you and I could say, wow, look at what Jesus is doing. Look at what God has done in your life. You are his workmanship. And the best part is when you can tell who a work of art belongs to because you recognize the style. Now, I'm sure most of you, if you saw a Van Gogh painting and you didn't know who it was, could say, oh, that looks like Van Gogh. Or if you read a poem, you could say, oh, that sounds like Shakespeare. You recognize the artist. Now, can I look at you and can I say, I see Jesus. I see Jesus. Can you look at me and see Jesus? Let us have his signature on our lives. You know, I mean, it's so special to be his workmanship. And he gives us examples of things that we could do to follow in his likeness. So in John 13, we see Jesus, after the Last Supper, get up, gird himself. He removes his garment, he girds himself, gets a basin, and he starts washing feet, right? What does Simon Peter say? He says, you shall never wash my feet, right? Because, of course, like, it's Jesus. And Jesus answered and said, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me, because he purifies us. He purifies his people. And the story goes on, and it's wonderful. We learn a lot of stuff from this story. We don't have enough time to get into. But he says, I have given you an example that you should follow. And this is the night before he's crucified. I would be really stressed out. I'd have other things on my mind. But he gives himself to his disciples to the very end, right? He teaches us how to serve others. He has set such a high example of humility and love and service and sacrifice. And we're blessed if we follow in it. And the irony is, if you read in Luke 22, right after the Last Supper, it says that the disciples were arguing with each other about which one of them was the greatest. So he must have been sitting there listening, and he's like, okay, I need to do this. I need to show him who's the greatest. And it's true, because the greatest of all is the least of all, the servant of all, right? And we're not commanded to be great. We are commanded to be faithful, to go and make disciples. Matthew 28, 19 and 20 says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. As women, we have seasons where we probably don't do as much traveling. You know, if you can go on the mission field and that's your calling, go, do it. But if you're at home taking care of little ones, or you just don't have the means to do it, the Lord has put so many people in your lives that you can disciple. You know, disciple them. People need care. People who believe in God, who love God, who are Christians, but because they live in a fallen world and they go out in public around other people, they get dirty feet, right? And we all get dirty feet. And like Jesus, we need to be washing the feet of our family symbolically with the water of the word, right? We need to minister when we see dirt. Pray, minister, don't judge or gossip. We also need to be humble in order to deal with the dirt in other people's lives, because it's embarrassing. I think of feet, right? I like how it's a symbol of feet, because I would be kind of uncomfortable if someone of you was looking at my feet right now. And it's just kind of uncomfortable, right? Like, I'd be wondering things, right? And it's the same thing with sin, right? It's uncomfortable. It's a little embarrassing to have somebody see the sin in your life and somebody be able to minister to that. So in order to minister to others, we need to be humble, safe, trustworthy, loving people so that people can feel safe with us. And then too, that's what Jesus was, right? We'll be like Jesus. And you're needed. Each one of you is needed. Somebody is in your life that needs your encouragement, that needs your ministry, fellowship. Paul, he instructs Titus earlier in chapter 2 on how the Cretan church should be discipling the younger generation. He's talking about the older women. He says first they need to get their lives in order. They shouldn't be drunkards or gossips. They get their lives in order, and then they can teach the younger generation, the younger women, to love, to be content, to be hardworking, to be sensible. But first, they have to be disciples first. And so there's so much that we can teach in a world that's falling apart. I mean, people have serious, serious problems. I mean, maybe some of us in this room are really, really struggling. Some people are ill. Some people have long-term illnesses that wear them out. Some people have terminal illnesses that scare them to death. Some people are depressed. Some people are trying to recover from past abuse, and they want to be okay, but it still hurts really bad. Some people are trying very hard each month just to make ends meet, and they need encouragement. So we need to be filled with the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, because they don't need my opinions, right? They don't need opinions. They need the Lord. And actually, they don't even need me to help them with their problems, because I can't. I can encourage them, and I can pray for them and minister to them, but they need to come alongside Jesus. Okay, because they are burdened and heavy laden, and they need Jesus. They need to take his yoke so we can bring them to Jesus. Hebrews 10, 24 through 25 says, "And let us consider one another to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling together of ourselves, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching." As we get closer and closer to the end, we are going to need each other even more. But our good works, our ministry, it never takes the place of time at Jesus' feet. If we don't sit with Jesus first, our ministry is going to be frazzled, and we're going to be overwhelmed, and it's going to be too much for us. And we see this in Luke chapter 10. Verse 38, Jesus was traveling along, and Martha welcomes him into her home, and she has a sister. Verse 39, it says, she had a sister called Mary who was seated at the Lord's feet, listening to his word. But Martha was distracted with all of her preparations, and she came up to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the serving alone? Tell her to help me." But the Lord answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and bothered about so many things, but only one thing is necessary, and Mary has chosen that good part, and it shall not be taken away from her." Martha was doing good, right? I mean, she was serving Jesus. She was doing good things. But it was too much for her because she thought she was too busy to sit at Jesus' feet. And notice, Jesus doesn't tell Mary, "Get up and go help your sister," because the answer to our problems is not that we need more human help, right? The answer to our problems is that we need to come to Jesus. So he invites her. You know, he basically says to her, "Come to me, take my yoke upon you, and learn from me," right? That's the answer. Otherwise, if we don't do that, we're going to be like Martha. We're going to be critical. We're going to be snapping at people and pointing fingers and frustrated, tired, and overwhelmed, you know? So, John 15, 5, or 4 through 5, Jesus says, "Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." Abiding in Christ. We need to be connected to him. We need him to help us make everything wonderful. Because on our own, it's just flesh, right? We have our fish. We have some bread. You know, it's not enough for everybody. But when we are connected to the Lord, he multiplies it. He does more with what we can do on our own. So we are created for good works. Ephesians 2:8, though, says that they were prepared beforehand by God that we should just walk in them. We do not need to wear ourselves out. We do not need to make ourselves extra busy doing things, right? We need to stay yoked to Jesus. And as he's leading us, he will walk us into those good works that he's prepared, because he doesn't want, the world is busy too, right? He doesn't want busy people. He wants, you know, people who are connected to him. And one more thing. I'm almost done. In verse 14, it says, who gave himself for us. He gave himself. He gave everything. And as I look at this verse and I consider what the Lord has done for us and what kind of saints he's transforming us into, I see that we have the potential to be even more influential than Oprah Winfrey and Jen Hatmaker and Joel Osteen, right? Because they may have publicists and multimedia marketing machines making them into celebrities, but their influence is temporary. It's carnal, right? The Lord is working in each one of us every day to minister to people. And that influence is eternal because we are his own special people. We have his fingerprint on our lives. We have his spirit flowing through our bodies. We have his word in our mouth. We have his righteousness being imputed and worked out through sanctification. We have the hope of his soon return. And we have Jesus right next to us. And one day we are going to stand before him and we are going to see him. And I want to think about that for a minute, okay? Because it blows my mind. Revelation chapter 1 describes him in his glory. It says, I saw one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like the flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. In his right hand he had seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. You are going to stand before him. This is our God, right? And earlier in Revelation, verse 5, it says, and I love this, to him who loved us and washed us in his own blood and has made us kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. How can we not take him seriously? He's the one who gave everything. And he still spoke in Matthew 28:20 and said, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. Jesus didn't just live for us. Jesus didn't just die for us. Jesus gave everything for us. Therefore, we need in return to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him if we really want to be his disciples, if we really want to be godly women in an ungodly world. Let me pray. Heavenly Father God, you are so glorious. Lord, you have done everything for us. All we need to do is surrender to you, Lord. I pray for the rest of this conference. I pray, Lord, that your spirit would minister to our hearts. Lord, that we would surrender. God, that we would be stirred up for works of service. Lord, that we would want to be more obedient to you, that we would want to be closer to you, that it wouldn't be out of obligation, but that it would be out of love, Lord. Please help us to love you more. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Thank you.